Offshore oil production is now recognized by everyone as that rich stuff that lubricates the whole economy of Newfoundland and Labrador. Last summer, Chevron Canada drilled an exploration well in the Orphan Basin, 400 kilometers northeast of St. John's. The results of that well haven't been announced yet, but the fact that the new well was drilled in waters 2,600 meters deep, a full 1,000 meters deeper than the Deepwater Horizon, which blew out in the Gulf of Mexico, has some people in the province asking questions.
Big ocean, big oil, big questions.
Recently, the Natural History Society of Newfoundland and Labrador hosted a public information session on environmental impacts of oil spills. Professor Bill Montevecchi from MUN was one of the speakers. Tony Power, manager of the Cape St. Mary's Ecological Reserve, was another speaker. He knows firsthand what happens when seabirds get slicked with oil.
When the oil gets on it, it loses its buoyancy and it starts sinking and can't feed. Then it starts to try and preen itself, swallows the oil, and then it gets inside.
Montevecchi has done radio tag tracking of the migration patterns of seabirds through the offshore. Millions of murres and other species winter on the water near the oil fields. Back in 2004, the Terra Nova FPSO, operated by Petro-Canada, spilled approximately 1,000 barrels of crude oil into the sea. They were fined $70,000.
There were no independent observers.
400 oiled seabirds were found 2 weeks later on the southern shore of the Avalon.
This is the most birds I've ever found.
19 of those birds were analyzed by Environment Canada, who said it was bilge oil from ships, not crude from Terra Nova.
Maybe that's true, but we never saw any information. We just got, that's what we were told.
More than birds can be impacted. Shrimp, crab, halibut, and cod fisheries also use these same waters.
You know, it's great that the oil industry is helping the economy of Newfoundland, but the ocean doesn't belong to the oil companies, and there's other reasons for having an ocean besides deep water drilling.
To keep an eye on things, there used to be government surveillance flights over offshore oil production, but they were discontinued several years ago.
Every time the planes flew over the rigs, they would always see slicks. And the oil company guys, and they've told me this directly, that's not oil. You know, that's drilling fluid. That's something else. It's not oil. No, that's what they would always say. It's not funny. It's exasperating. And because they convinced the government that it was only ships that were doing this, they decided not to fly over the rigs anymore. The government made that decision.
The CNLOPB, the Canada Newfoundland Labrador Offshore Petroleum Board, is responsible for environmental oversight of offshore oil. Who's on this board? An oceanographer in tonight's audience had looked into that question.
When I looked for the biographies of all the board members, I haven't found a single line about anything connected with biology, with ecology, business connections, trade unions, other things. There is not a single line suggesting any understanding of biological processes.
Alan Stein is president of the Natural History Society of Newfoundland, and he's had personal experience at the CNLOPB.
The committees I served on, I was the token outside environmentally aware person on a committee of about two dozen, mainly with representatives of government, different departments of federal and provincial government, and of the oil companies and the oil company associations CAP.
Odds like that prompt Montevecchi to ask questions like this.
What is the relationship between our regulator, the CNLOPB, and the oil companies?
Close.
Very close. Intimate.
On the other hand, environmental observers are kept at a distance.
There are no independent observers on oil platforms. We've been asking for this for more than 10 years. Formally asking for this hasn't happened.
Just before Christmas, Canada's Commissioner of the Environment, Scott Vaughan, said that Canada is unprepared to react quickly to a major oil spill at sea. This meeting encouraged participation by the public, so all sides can get in on the debate.
And a lot of them will say, look, if we don't cut a certain kind of deal, the companies are going to go elsewhere because it's expensive to drill here, it's expensive to operate here, and there's a certain amount of leverage, I think.
Sure, we want the oil, like you said, and there have to be compromises, but sometimes you just have to make a stand, you know, for the environment.
It's up to all of us to go out and do something. And maybe one of us can't do anything, but if people keep writing into the telegram, getting into the phone-in shows, getting hold of your local politicians.
We all have to say, we have to have observers on the platforms, and we have to keep saying that over.
This year, Chevron plans to do seismic surveys, sweeping 37,000 square kilometers of seabed with high-volume sound waves. So potential damage to whales and fish stocks could also enter into the debate. Any concrete suggestions to provide stronger safeguards?
This is broken. It can't be fixed. There has to be an independent environmental board.
The birds, they're not prepared. No, I don't think we're prepared.
It will be a challenge to make everybody happy on this issue. But one thing's for sure, offshore oil development in Newfoundland and Labrador is certain to continue. For NTV News, I'm Steve Thompson.